I'd like to call this meeting to order. I'd like to remind everybody to turn their cell phones to silent. Mr. Blaine is under the weather and Dr. Meyer is out of town, but we still have a quorum. I'd like us all to stand as I ask Ms. Blaylock to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
At 1.03, can I have a motion to adopt the agenda this evening?
So moved.
I'll second.
Motion made by Mrs. Blaylock, second by Mr. Braswell. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. And now we'd like to welcome Dr. Baker for item 2.01, presentation of the superintendent's fiscal year 2018 recommended budget.
Good evening. Hopefully everyone can hear me okay. I'm just checking my sound. There we go. Just making sure that we've got the presentation up. That's not meant to symbolize the budget, the black. The turn to black is not meant to be a precursor of things to come, but I guess as we await that. Hi, everyone. How are you? Good, good, good. I can start off by saying something really positive to start while we wait for this to come up. I know that there's a lot of budget uncertainty right now, but there are a couple things that I'm pretty certain about for tomorrow that I think will make staff happy and maybe not students. I really think we're going to be able to make it to school tomorrow. But the other bit of news is I'm quite certain that all the staff members that I see in the audience tonight, you're going to get a paycheck tomorrow. It's been a long time, hasn't it? Yeah.
Sure. We have a motion for a 5-minute recess.
I second that motion.
I don't think you need a second for a recess, but so all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Yeah. Oh, no, that's okay. Well, I have.
to order now. Dr. Baker, would you like to resume with 2.01?
Okay. Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the board. Hopefully you can still hear me okay. All right. Before I begin, I want to thank some people who've been instrumental in developing and preparing this proposal. This year, one overarching goal that I set for myself as superintendent was to continue to try and further personalize leadership for the many I have the pleasure of serving. And in that vein, I wanted to first, though I've never publicly thanked them, especially prior to a budget presentation, like to express my sincere and abundant gratitude to my own family. They drive and inspire me to give the best that is in me, even though sometimes that feels inadequate. Next, I want to thank my cabinet and finance staff that is behind me. Our team is truly second to none, and it's a pleasure to work alongside each of them. And I'm quite sure I learn as much or more from each of them than I'm able to impart. Finally, so many were actively engaged in various levels of discourse, survey, collaboration, and decision-making leading up to what I'm going to share with you. I want to thank the following groups of folks: the teacher advisory, the parent advisory team, the strategic planning team, audit and finance committee, compensation focus group, STAND, the acronym STAND for my student advisory team, building principals, many of which are here tonight, and the teen outreach network committee that has worked with me in trying to continue to advocate for our students and community needs. Finally, I want to thank you, the school board, for continuing to represent the best interests of our students, staff, and community through your genuine and tireless advocacy. So in the past, I have tried to seamlessly move through a presentation, and this being the fifth budget that I have presented to this school board, tonight I'm going to talk to you. And I'm not asking you to talk back to me, but I'm going to talk to you a little bit about really setting the stage for this budget season. And the title of this presentation, Maximizing Our Resources, Transcending the New Normal Through Our People, is one that hopefully will resonate as we go through. But it is about trying to maintain and enhance all that we provide as a school division for our students in light of what is really no longer a phase or a cycle, but truly the new normal that we have to navigate through in terms of the fiscal realities. You know that we're the 13th largest school division. It's important and helpful to view a budget in a number of different lenses and contexts and perspectives. And I think it's always important to remember that we are one of the largest school divisions in the Commonwealth. And while we have 17 elementary schools and 12 secondary schools and two other sites that provide instructional programming for our students, we strive to not just be a set of isolated schools located in one county, but instead an interconnected system or school system. This week we have it's not a holiday, but it's a day that we tend to take note of annually called Groundhog Day. And if any of you have ever seen the movie that came out many years ago called Groundhog Day, sometimes when you're presenting a budget, and this, as I said, is my fifth budget, you do get that feeling sometimes that you've been here before, that this was the same thing that you experienced or said or encountered in a previous day or in a previous year. And it was 5 years ago that I shared this same slide at a time when the recession that we were coming out of still had a significant hold on our public school division. And I'm going to read it to you and then talk again about what it may mean for us as we move forward. Leadership does not begin with a vision. The vision is very important. It begins with getting people to confront the brutal facts and to act on the implications. And one of the primary ways to demotivate people is by ignoring the brutal facts of our reality. And I share that today not to depress, but to signal that the many fiscal challenges or brutal facts that we must confront are the same ones that we had to confront last year and the year before and 5 years ago, and to some extent, all the way back to 2008-09. The overarching brutal fact, and I've listed several of these as persistent challenges, which I think have to first be viewed in terms of our challenge going forward, is that the Commonwealth has never really recovered from the Great Recession economically. And despite bipartisan cooperation regarding accountability and accreditation reform, the stark reality is that increases in expectations and accountability rigors have not been matched by a commitment in funding those very expectations. And while I do encourage continued advocacy and appropriate resources to these realities, equal or greater measure of organizational focus and resolve must continue in order for our school division to meet the increasing challenges and needs of our students and staff. And as you look at these persistent challenges, and I won't read them all to you, but you can see that right now, Spotsylvania County Public Schools public education is funded at a lower percentage at the state and local level. Our bread and butter funding-wise is our cost per pupil, our enrollment, our average daily membership, and as that has been slightly declining, that has meant less funding from the state. The past two local composite indexes, for us, those adjustments have gone up, which also means less funding from the state. You couple that with mandatory cost increases in health insurance and VRS that are outpacing any increases that we might achieve through state, local, and federal funding. And what you have, in essence, continues to be that perfect storm of circumstances that makes it very challenging to increase your budget capacity. And while we have seen this nationally, we are now beginning to face it as a state. And though we have done well the past few seasons, there is a growing shortage of qualified and desired candidates for employment in the education field. And we will be continuing to compete for human resources, high quality, qualified human resources within a shrinking pool. And with all of that said, the real dichotomy for us is as our funding goes down due to lower enrollment, the very students that we are seeing the most significant increase in, which are students with disabilities, students in poverty, and students who are English learners, that has gone up sharply over the last 5 to 10 years. And it is important that we face the reality that we must address them, their needs effectively and equitably. So I wanted to share with you some revenue and funding trends that go all the way back to the beginning of the recession. I'm going to first start with just the budgets that I've been a part of here in Spotsylvania to show you that where we find ourselves today, and I'm giving you already a sneak preview into where we're going to find ourselves as far as the bottom line. You see that each year that we have come, or I have come to propose a budget, we are usually in a deficit position at some level. Sometimes it's been higher than others, depending on mandatory costs. Sometimes it depends on what some of the needs are that we are arguing for. But the bottom line is that we begin each budget season in the new normal in a budget deficit. It's also important to note when you look at these, just the last 5 years, the revenue variances at all three of the levels of funding, you can see that it's inconsistent at best in terms of funding. It's hard to predict from year to year what your funding is going to look like, and that has implications for how we continue to approach budgets. But you can see that the growth over time has been minimal, and 1 year it appears to be a lot more, and another year it is significantly less. But what is not always shown in these variances are the other costs that come that outpace any increases we might receive at the state, federal, and local level. This chart goes all the way back to FY 2008, and you can see just the breakdown of funds by category, sales tax and state funding, federal funds, city and county funds, other funds, loans, bonds, etc. And you can see that over really a 10-year cycle, there has been minimal increase in the bottom line. And this chart further depicts what the local and state funding trends have been for us here in Spotsylvania. Jim Regenball, who is a founder of Fiscal Analytics, he presents a lot to the various educator groups, including the Association of School Superintendents, the School Boards Association, and you can see his assessment of where we find ourselves. Even at the beginning of the last biennium, we are now in the second year of the most recent biennium, you can see his assessment in terms of the state is still significantly underfunding K-12 education. It's also important to note a fact regarding where we fare in Spotsylvania County in terms of our per pupil funding comparison. Out of 132 school divisions, we rank, as you will see in the next slide, 35th, and in compared with the state average per pupil funding, we are below that. And there you see ranked 85th, which means that we are really in the bottom third in terms of cost per pupil. And in comparing us with the 15 largest school divisions in the state, we have the fifth lowest cost per pupil among those school divisions. There's a couple of different ways that the board and the audience may want to view that. You may want to view that as a positive. We continue to maximize our resources, which is one of the themes of tonight's presentation that I'm sharing with you. At the same time, imagine what we might be able to do if we could be at a different place in terms of our overall funding. As I mentioned earlier, our local composite index adjustments represents the most recent trends, and we have been going upward. When the LCI increases, that is usually an indication, whether we want to call it an accurate or flawed methodology, and there's lots of different perspectives on that. The bottom line is that when that is state funding is reduced, there is a hope that local funds would then increase according to that local composite index adjustment. And then you see our student enrollment trends and how we have, since 2006, declined by over 600 students. And though we see a potential of beginning to move upward in our enrollment in the next few years, our normal right now is that flat or slightly declining enrollment is something that we must continue to grapple with in terms of managing our funding. And it's further exemplified here in the ADM, the average daily membership chart as well. And as I mentioned in the persistent challenges, we welcome and embrace our students with disabilities. As a former special education teacher, I am excited that many families want to come to Spotsylvania County, and I'm quite confident because of the quality services that we provide for students with disabilities, particularly in the areas that we find ourselves growing the most, in the areas of autism and significant learning disabilities, low incidence, high intensity need populations of students that we are eager to serve, but cost a great deal more to serve on a daily basis and an annual basis. And you can see our trend going up in general special education over the last five fiscal years. But as I said before, the areas where we are growing the most significantly are in the areas where there is the greatest need. And then you can also see a trend of English learners also increasing in terms of need in our school division. I share this to, again, go back to we have not yet recovered, and we may never fully recover from the recession in the manner that we thought we would. I think there was initially an expectation that we're gonna move through this, and at some point, we will be fully restored. You know, what we had prior to the recession will come back. I think this is an evidence that it is not going to come back anytime soon, and I think that again is the brutal fact that we have to confront. You can see that in all of the areas, with the exception of transportation, where I would venture that the majority of the increase need in transportation has been, again, due to additional special education needs. You can see that we have declined in our full-time equivalent positions across the board. And if you look at this chart, you can see that we are still not back to pre-recession levels, even in the percentage of our teachers per enrollment. So for this year, I wanted to highlight some investments that are a part of the bottom line. The first thing that when you take out all of the capital improvement plan, our debt service, and you just focus in on how do we invest, you see that almost 88% of our operating fund is dedicated to people. And then only 12% is dedicated to non-compensation or non-personnel, which again, in terms of making adjustments in your annual budget, you can see that that's not an easy proposition when you consider that we primarily do our work and are successful through the people that we invest in. I want to applaud the school board, not only since I have been here, but even prior, to being dedicated to preserving as much as possible reasonable class sizes. And you can see that we've not only been able to maintain that over the last few years, but your investments in continuing to preserve and increase positions as applicable has been able to keep us at least at a manageable per pupil rate, not only at elementary, but even at secondary. Again, we've talked before that these averages certainly should not be misinterpreted, that all of our classrooms look just like that, you know, at 24 students in each classroom, because we have some that may go much higher, we have some that may go significantly lower. But I do think that for now, I appreciate the board's resolve in continuing to stick to maintaining those appropriate levels of service at the classroom level. These are our salary increase trends, and you can see that beginning in 2015, that was the year that we made a decision with the school board's support to begin to build in as a budgetary assumption at least a reasonable annual pay increase for all of our staff. And in doing that, it forced us to work from that deficit position because it was set as a priority. Some may disagree with that. You know, begin with what you have and then build your priorities. But having watched two fiscal years, folks internally and externally struggle with the decisions of more resources or compensate adequately, compensate fairly the people that have continued to invest themselves in what we're doing and have been loyal to not only Spotsylvania County, but to this vocation of public education. We said we're going to reward them and we're going to keep them and we are going to invest in them. And you can see the trend over the last 3 years that we've been able to maintain. And I certainly have to extend my gratitude to our local governing body last fiscal year for being able to provide enough funding locally that we could maintain that consistency. Without that, we would not have been able to provide the 2% cost of living increase last year. And as we look ahead, we are proposing again a 2% cost of living increase for all of our staff. So these proposed investments, you can see what the related costs are. And you can see that we're breaking out those costs because oftentimes when you begin in a deficit position, there's a belief that a laundry list or a significant list of budgetary items have been compiled that feed a budget gap. But as will be reinforced as I continue, you can see that just the cost of living increase alone is a significant cost. Then when you factor in the mandatory costs and health insurance, and a whopping 11% increase in mandatory costs for VRS, that is by itself puts us in a deficit position. We are having a better year this year thanks to the retirement of some older debt that our debt service for this upcoming CIP is much better than it was last year. But another bit of good news, we are going to be able to recommend this year the reinstatement of the hourly cafeteria aides at the elementary level. It's being done as a pilot program thanks to the buildup of a reserve in our food service program that we can allocate that funding towards. So it is not something that comes to you proposed unfunded. I share with you because I'm going to, there's a couple other funded proposals that I want to share with you. And sometimes when we look at participation in athletics or we look at students who are involved in activities, when that goes up, it may suggest that certainly our schools are doing a great job of promoting opportunities to students. I think it also speaks to, as those rates increase, we must continue to think about leveraging resources to meet the needs of all of our students. As our school division has increased in diversity, has increased in poverty, we must be able to provide equal access to programs, not only in athletics, but academic services, as well as clubs and activities that are lifelines for many of our students. So with that, I am proposing in this budget, through reallocations, a pilot academic and athletic activity bus program. We are still working through the details. I'd like to thank in advance both the principals from Post Oak Middle School and Spotsylvania High School who have been working to try to develop a proposal that we can pilot this program. We would like in the long run for there to be access to activity and athletic bus runs across the school division. But what we want to do right now, and I know that each member of this school board has been very vocal, has been very supportive, and really has banged on the table for activity buses. Before I came, since I've been here, and when I go, if they're not fully reinstated, they'll still be banging on the table. But I do want to share that the focus that I have as superintendent and I have worked through with the staff is this is not about a restoration of something from the past. This is about not only being able to provide transportation for students who want to engage in after-school activities such as athletics, but it is also to continue to leverage our resources so that we can provide a continuum of education services to students who need it the most. Some students need more than a 6 to 7 hour school event in order to have their learning needs met. And we want to begin to develop some capacity in that. So we are going to continue to work through that as we go through work sessions throughout the budget season. We'll provide more details as to what this pilot may look like, but we have at least been able to secure some foundational or seed funding in order to be able to move it forward. Also, last year, one of the things that we had to take off the table during a very difficult budget season was restoration of both academic and athletic stipends. We are, again, proposing that those be increased by 5%, as well as our substitute rates, finding that substitute needs continue to increase, as well as wanting to be competitive across other school divisions. We also know that it has been a goal of this school division to continue to sunset or lower the athletic fee over time. And as you see the increased participation, what's not shown in those numbers is there are students who may not be able to afford the athletic fee, and we want to make sure that we're at least trying to address that incrementally over time. Also, I know that it was of considerable interest not only to one of our school board members, but even prior to Mr. Twigg, I know that there had been interest in expanding the REACH special education program. We've been able to locate within our capital improvement plan an opportunity to view this as a project that would not only be able to expand that program, and right now we are looking at Massaponics High School as the potential destination for that, but it also could be a way to have increased capacity in other programs over time. Also, knowing that we had $2.1 million last year in one-time funding, we have made across-the-board non-compensation reductions to account for that, as well as you all are aware that when the state removed the salary increase from last year's budget, we had to continue to maintain enough revenue to honor our contracts. So what does our funding look like? Well, if you're looking at it by all funds, you can see that when you bring in our capital improvement plan and you bring in loans and bonds, you can see what the breakdown looks like. Then when you look by category, you can see that breakdown. Again, the lion's share going to instruction. Again, this includes all of our budget accounts. We take out our capital improvement plan. You can see, again, the breakdown. Again, by revenue source. And then when you look by category, again, the lion's share of instruction, almost up to 67% going towards instruction. And when you break that down just by the category, it's just another way to view it. And overall, this is a $7.6 million or 2.7% increase over last year's budget. But again, as we will discuss, that is not how much revenue we have been given an increase. That is the proposal itself. So when we just look at our operating funds, you can see what the total variance is between state, federal, city, and other funds. And that also reveals the revenue gap that we have. Then the breakdown by operating fund revenues, you can see a pretty strong split between state and county funding. And that also includes the revenue gap of $6.5 million. And then you can see again the lion's share of our money going towards instruction, and almost up to 70% of our operating fund goes towards instruction. And then this is again the breakdown by object, just another way for you to view it. I wanted to point out, as we go into another budget season where the school board will have to grapple with how do we manage a funding gap. And you will note at the end that I will again bring up many of the same options that exist each year for how do you bring down a funding gap based on a budget proposal. But I don't want to miss the opportunity to not only thank all of the folks that on an annual basis, including this school board, work so hard to make our operation as efficient as possible and to look at many ways that we have avoided costs or saved costs in order to make our investments to maximize our investments as much as possible. And so here's just a few ways that the division has balanced prior year budgets. The very first year that I was superintendent, we began a restructure of our central office, particularly in the instruction area. And really, I would say the new normal for school divisions, and ours is no exception, is that you're constantly restructuring. You are in flux. You are constantly reworking how we work because there may not be enough people to do all of the jobs that exist. So you have to continually look for ways to maximize your people. And you can see we've had two early retirement programs that have helped to save costs, but certainly there, it could be argued what you lose in that process as well. You can see across the board non-compensation. Appreciate the school, the county helping us with refinancing to lower our debt service. And you can see the deferment of CIP projects. And then each year, we are always hopeful that we at least receive some minimal increases in what the governor proposal and what the General Assembly often delivers, and then the same for the locality. These are examples of 10-year cost containment implementations that, again, began prior to my coming on board as superintendent, but they represent many ways of trying to work smarter, to work more efficiently, and to put more of our funding towards instruction and children directly in the classroom. The outsourcing of food services, the outsourcing of custodial services, the joint fleet maintenance operation, joint health insurance contracts, use of interest earned versus borrowing, refinancing CIP debt with the assistance of the county, that was also mentioned. Now we are trying to invest in LED lighting to achieve savings over time in terms of energy costs, and then choosing to focus on renovations versus expansions and expansions versus new construction, especially as we find our enrollment flat and slightly declining. So the preliminary budget gap, our preliminary revenues up against our projected expenditures leaves a preliminary budget gap of $6.475 million. And you can see what accounts for that budget gap. It is primarily these items, the descriptions there that I have already reviewed. Those are what makes up the unfunded portion of this budget proposal. So I guess that's a combination of the brutal facts and the persisting challenges and maybe the bad news. So I want to now shift to talking to you about how we continue to try to maximize the investment that we receive, regardless of what the future holds. And though I shared the first part of Jim Collins' example of confronting the most brutal facts of your current reality, the other part of that, it's called the Stockdale paradox, is to retain faith, and I'll call it hope, that in the end, we will prevail regardless of the difficulties. And I have great confidence and optimism about that because we continue as a school division to focus on quality, to focus on making sure that what we do is of the highest quality, whether it is instruction in the classroom, whether it is leadership, whether it's customer service. And have we arrived and are we there? Absolutely not. But in trying to build a culture of continuous improvement, we will never stop striving for that. And I believe that that focus will continue to position us well in the future. The main way that we focus on quality is by focusing on who we have on our bus, who is actually doing the service. And I am so proud to serve in a school division with such fantastic, talented, dedicated people each and every day at all levels of the organization. And here this is if there's any advice that I'm going to provide to the school board, because when this night is over, this will truly be your budget. It will be one through which myself and the staff will do all that we can to support you in your deliberations and providing whatever information you need. But in this new norm, the school board is going to have to take ownership of how do we move forward. So I share that despite concerning funding trends and continued budget uncertainty, we can and should remain confident regarding the future. And that's because we have the finest staff, the finest students, community and leaders, and they exemplify our mission, which you're going to hear about ad nauseum in just a second. And they propel us forward, as evidenced by continuous improvement efforts and results that I'll also share. So in the new normal of annual fiscal uncertainty and annual budget shortfalls, we should remain steadfast in our commitment to valuing, honoring, celebrating, and rewarding the ever-challenging work of people delivering the services. So how does our school division already maximize with the strained resources and an attempt to transcend fiscal challenges? What I'm going to flash up, we are a school division that is focused intently, maybe appropriately, obsessively, with strategic planning, with making sure that results that we achieve are achieved through design, through intentionality, not through accidents, not through luck, not through good fortune, but through deliberate planning that involves the entire school community, that helps us to continue to strive to be that culture of collaboration. And I'm going to show you over the next few slides, you're going to see pictures, many of which were taken right here in this boardroom over the past year, that represent, we could call them the rock stars of the school division, but I think we have such a reservoir of talent and goodness that I think these folks are just scratching the surface. But right there in the center of the first picture, I had the opportunity to go to Richmond last week and see our Region 3 Teacher of the Year and Division Teacher of the Year, Carolyn Kleinert, honored again. We are so proud of her, one of our Spanish teachers at Freedom Middle School. But you can see in this collage a number of our staff, including we have a couple staff right behind me that have continued to oversee a budget process that has been acknowledged in a budget award each year over the past decade. You can see many of our students who have won district, region, state, and national awards. Together, we prepare our students for their future. And every day, these folks are exemplifying that. Our staff that are preparing them and our students who are achieving. And you can further see that. We're also going to share in a moment that we have amazing business partners. We have folks from our community that step up when we have challenges. And I think we have also developed enough capacity in that that I'm confident that we're going to continue to have their support as we move forward. So as I say here, we are seeing many of our folks, students, staff, community, parents, living the mission. Well, I talked earlier about you have to begin with the brutal facts. Vision is so important right now, especially in light of difficult circumstances. So you can see that our students are at the heart of our vision. They're beautifully diverse. They come from a range of backgrounds. And as we are seeing those increased needs, I ask that we view that not as a challenge, not as a burden, but as an extraordinary opportunity to continue to make the difference where without us, many of our students, many of their families might not have the opportunities that we are providing for them. And vision is so important not only for what we achieve in 1 year or 2 year, but it's important to continue to look into the distance, to look beyond the horizon. And I have continued and engaged my staff, and they have continued to look at what can our school division look like in the next 5 to 10 years. And I talked earlier about personalizing leadership, and sometimes we talk about personalizing learning in the classroom. I believe that over time we are going to want to create personalized learning centers so that our educational opportunity, particularly at the secondary level, is customized to what students need in order to propel them into a career or into college or into whatever they choose to do in the future. And you can see the light bulb of personalized learning in all the many areas that we are trying to develop. Some we have already begun to plant those seeds and start those programs, including an international baccalaureate program at Spotsylvania High School, the AP Capstone program at Riverbend and Massaponics High School. We are developing a STEM agriculture program at Spotsylvania High School. And you can see all of these represent an expanding vision that I'm very excited to be a part of. Our core values about how we behave, how we interact, and you can see the makeup of our staff here. I always note the last one. When we invest in our people, we invest in our community. Over 70% of our staff reside right here in Spotsylvania County, so they are direct stakeholders, and in many cases, they are also consumers of the services they are part of providing. And as we want to prepare all of our students to be college and career ready, we first have to look at the ultimate outcome is for our students to graduate, and when they graduate, that they don't graduate and say what's next, but they are graduating with skills and knowledge and the ability to take the next step wherever they want that next step to be, to not be limited in their opportunities, but to be poised to be propelled into the future. So when we look at how are we achieving our strategic plan in the area of teaching and learning, I just highlight a few areas where we have evidence of continuous improvement. I think it's important, especially if you go back to the slides that I shared earlier about our cost per pupil, about our strained resources over time. Despite that, and why I continue to compel you to focus on our staff, to focus on investing in them, is because they continue to perform. They continue under all range of circumstances, all sorts of challenges, to continue to help us as a school division improve. From a 5% rise in on-time graduation rate over the last 5 years to significant increases in math and reading performance, and then to see our achievement gaps in all areas of minority groups, economically disadvantaged, Hispanic, and students with disabilities, we are seeing, sometimes slowly, but we are seeing constant improvement each year. You can see more evidence of that at both the middle and high school levels. And though we want to not only match state levels, but we want to exceed state averages over time, we are also seeing improving trends in our advanced placement participation and scores on exams, as well as our SAT, ACT, and CTE performance and participation. So one of the main ways that we do this is the second part of our strategic plan, which is through community engagement and partnerships. And you can see from the pictures here, we have so much that we are building as a school community. We have a host of business partners and partners in education that I'll highlight in a moment. But we have folks that are providing us grants. We have folks that are stepping up to do the work with us in schools as volunteers. And we are even getting to the place, I believe, where we are going to one day have folks on hand in our schools to provide mentoring and support to families directly in the limited time that they have off. You can see here the increase in our partners in education over the past few years. A real shout out to our Director of Communications and Community Engagement, Renee Daniels, because she in a department of two basically work with all of the staff, all of the principals, to continue to increase our capacity of community support. And in the area, the final area of our strategic plan, organizational climate and school safety, you can see just a few highlights of continuous improvement in our positive behavior intervention support, training, and effective implementation. That has led to what we see in the final check mark of decline in disciplinary incidents and suspension rates. I, again, never claim that we've solved that, but I certainly think that we have impacted it. Structural enhancements to building entrances, really it's been a transformation. If you go to many of our schools and see the difference, what it used to look like when you walked into a school versus what it looks like now, and certainly enhanced visitor protocols to, again, make our schools as safe as possible so that the learning can take place that needs to. So despite these fiscal challenges, how have we continued to set and keep pace with many other school divisions who are providing similar services? You can see here the CTE completers. I don't have it compared to our state, but I know that we are one of the top school divisions in terms of our students who complete the two-year programs. Our industry certifications are beginning to skyrocket with in response to additional requirements. And again, I applaud our CTE staff for their work with that, as well as our building principals. And you can see that our graduation rates for CTE now exceed the state averages. I show this graphic because I think it's telling, and it's something that I've shared internally with staff, and I'm going to share it with you as a school board. Jim Collins also said that good is the enemy of great. We are on the cusp, I believe, as a school division, of truly living out our vision of leading the way in the state of Virginia. We are right on the cusp of beginning to not only meet but exceed state averages, again, despite the challenge and resources that we've had over the past few years. So I show that because I want us 5 years from now to be able to see where we have gone. And when we compare ourselves to larger school divisions that also have similar demographic challenges as we do, we're right there. We're not there. We're not at the top. We're not at the bottom. But we're right there. We want all students to be successful, not just in Spotsylvania, but across the state and nation. But there has to be a little bit in us that says we want to be competitive enough that we continue to do the best we can for our students. And these are two views of both the federal SOL pass rates in math, and then with state adjustments, you can see very similar. And when we look at the accreditation status for the largest 15 school divisions, you can see again that we are right there. We're keeping pace. We're not at the top, but given our challenges in terms of need and demographics, we are right there. And our three schools that have not yet been able to maintain or achieve full accreditation are very, very close, and we're very optimistic that soon we will be at the top of this list. So I shared this final graphic with you before getting to the bottom line and concluding this presentation. Share with you that when I say that it's an honor to work with the people that we have in the school division, this graphic represents intentionality, it represents alignment, it represents a focus on what we are here to do, which is ultimately to be transformative agents in the lives of children. We are here to, and often, many times, be the difference in their lives. All of us can remember some adult, some teacher, somebody that if it had not been for them, we would not be where we are today. So if you look at all of the alignment with our strategic plan into our teaching and learning framework, you see in the very center, students. Because despite advancements in technology, despite all we know about instructional pedagogy, isn't it ironic that what our students need the most right now is a relationship? They need us to love them. And it's an honor to work in a place that is embracing that as a mission, to love children and to do all they can to support them each and every day. That's worth investing in. So the next steps. I share the budget gap closing options, many of which you have seen in the past, but I want to share them a little bit differently than maybe have been shared in the past. Usually I will suggest to you that when we get to the end of a budget cycle, once we have all of the knowns, particularly we've solidified what the final transfer is going to be from the state and the local government, that's when we begin to determine how we're going to close the budget gap. But there are a couple pieces in here that are options that I want to share with you that I would encourage the school board to look at beginning with its work session this Wednesday, and that is on our health plans. We are, again, in an era of great uncertainty. Just when you think you're understanding where health insurance is going, you realize that it could all change. So one of the things that I would encourage the school board to look at is consideration of potential adjustments to our health insurance that could lower costs but still maintain the quality or the overall quality of the benefit in order for us to be able to have additional fiscal capacity. One of the reasons that I do not propose that tonight is because I, at present, am not getting enough optimistic data coming from the state. And again, our projected revenue from the locality is level from last year, minus 2.1 in one-time funding. So I am not optimistic right now that we will achieve the funding necessary through the state or local government or federal government to be able to close the budget gap. So before I would want to propose an adjustment to health insurance, we first need to know, are we going to be adjusting health insurance, increasing costs on employees without being able to provide a comparable pay increase at the same time? So that certainly is a significant consideration. But I do think it's important for the school board to be looking at all of the different options, and as we will discuss Wednesday night, beginning to look at how can we modernize or adjust our health insurance, still maintaining that quality, and looking at it over a five-year increment. And then finally, one of the ones at the top, the school board can reduce the comp that's been proposed. You have that option. I am encouraging you to consider investing in people and continuing to maintain that in terms of the pay increase, but that is certainly something that you do not have to maintain in the budget. You can also suggest that we can continue to cut people. And so I say that because I would rather hear it in a public session than to wonder why I'm not hearing it later, if that is indeed a strategy that the school board believes is the way to go. So if you believe that we need to consider looking at lowering our costs through reduction in employees or a reduction in employee salaries that I have proposed tonight, then I certainly encourage you to have that discussion and discourse as we move forward. And so finally, our budget dates. The snow tried to get us, but we got this one in. So I'm really excited about that. And so Wednesday night, we will have our first school board budget work session. And then we have another one on the 7th. And then you can follow the dates from there. So again, I appreciate your patience. I appreciate you allowing me to talk to you tonight. Appreciate all the folks that are in attendance. And I look forward to working with the school board during this budget season. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Dr. Baker. And now we will move on to board member comments, and we'll start with Ms. Shelley.
Thank you. Okay, Dr. Baker, thank you very much. And thank your staff. I want to thank the staff, any finance, cabinet, anyone that was involved in the budget, all of the the teams, the task force, everyone, please, I just want to thank all of you. It's really hard. So that's the first thing I want to do. I want to say you are absolutely right. One of the last things you said, that we are sometimes the difference in the students' lives. Absolutely. It's relationships. And that's why we have to make sure that we have the best staff we can get. And it means paying them. Because if somebody can come here, or they can go across the river to another place, and they're going to make a little bit more money and have the same job, they might just be going across the river. And I think it's very important that we continue to pay our staff. So I want to thank you again for putting that 2% increase. The activity buses, everything that you put in, I did notice that there were no more new FTEs put into the budget, which kind of sad, because we could always use more staff. Looking at our EL number, our English language learners, and our L population, and it continues to grow. I think it's over doubled or tripled since I've been on the board. We need more support. And what I write down, 62 languages. Folks, 62 different languages our students are coming to Spotsylvania County speaking. It's not just one or two languages, it's 62. We do not have 62 different translators to translate for these children. We're having to teach them in English and hope they can understand it. Oh, and by the way, they have to take an SOL in English. And that is something that I don't know if people understand. Everyone knows I teach. We have students coming in from Korea, Thailand, the Middle East, Hispanic countries, all over, speaking all these different languages. And I look at them and I love them as much as we can. I mean, immediately we fall in love with them. But it's when we know that the children, it's the children, and they have to pass that SOL. So I really wish we could add more ELL teachers. I really, really, really do, to help our kids. Special education, we know that's near and dear to my heart. That's increased since I've been on the board. And we need more people to help our SPED. We need more support in our special education classrooms. But we've got a great team out there. We've got great teachers in the classrooms, and they're doing, and our kids are showing growth. And that's huge. I could go on and on, but I've got a whole lot of people here that want to say something. My heart is with our kids. And my heart is with our staff. And without good staff, our kids are nowhere. So, Dr. Baker, thank you so much. One more thing I do want to add. Last week, I was at a conference. The governor spoke. And he said that he is bringing a company to Virginia. And this is for all of you and everybody watching. He is bringing a huge company to Virginia from California. And the reason they're coming to Virginia is because of our schools. People come to places because of schools. We want people to continue to come to Spotsylvania County. We need to show them we have the best schools in this state. And I know we're trying. And yeah, sometimes it takes more money, which we don't have at this point. But we're going to keep working. And I want to thank the staff, all of our teachers, our paras, our custodians are everybody, and I'm not going to name everybody because I know I'll forget somebody, but they're always doing their job, and the kids come first for them. So thank them, and Dr. Baker, thank you for this budget.
And Mr. Twigg?
Thank you for an excellent presentation, for the good results. Our challenge, and even more importantly, your challenge, however, is to establish new norms, new baselines. And I've seen several areas where we can accept that challenge and accept the challenge together to where, you know, even based on our position in state statistics or X dollars per student, I believe that those types of challenges could receive a new norm or have a new norm established. And in the end, probably do more or as much with less. And again, our statistics, our quality, as far as output, I'm impressed with that. But I'd like to propose that our board considers the less part and includes more with less. The change is constant, and both we and you and our quality staff have to embrace that and embrace it more. And with reference to those challenges. So I'll reserve some specific comments that I have till Wednesday and look forward to it. Thank you for the presentation again.
Mrs. Blaylock.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to first thank Dr. Baker, his staff, great presentation, and also for the hard work that went in. I know it's a group effort, and I love the way you talked about loving children. It's about them, and that's why we do this. And I was sitting here thinking when you were saying that, our two school board members who can't be here because of Mr. Blaine is ill, and Dr. Meyer is working with his family with some illnesses in his family and is out of the country. They're both calling us before this meeting and saying, we'll be watching every minute. And I looked around at my board. I've never worked with a group of people more dedicated to one effort than I do with these people around me. And the two that are absent are just as much present as I am. I can promise you that. It's a good place to be when you work with a group that is all about the kids. We are seeing results. I love that slide where you compared us to the state. If you remember, I talked to you all the time about, I want to be the best in the state. I want to be the best in the country. And then I want our kids to compete abroad. I want them to be on the same level when they graduate one of our five high schools as every other child that graduates a high school at any high school in the country, in the world, anywhere. And I saw that tonight, that we are beginning to make those strides that we talked about years ago when you first came back to Spotsylvania County, and that's so rewarding. We're going to get down to the nitty-gritty. I will not touch on the details or specific questions. It's actually kind of inappropriate tonight because we are coming to a work session on Wednesday, so this is really just an overview of, you got to remember, we see it for the first time as you see it. The school board does as well. So, I mean, if I didn't say something about activity buses, something where somebody would think I was sick this evening. That has been a passion of mine. If anybody's followed the school board closely, when it was voted to stop the service, I was against it then. I am so glad to see that we are implementing something back, and although it appeared that the pilot program may not be right in my district, you know, I'll be right behind the Livingston District and the Berkeley District pushing for it to get back over to mine, but I understand that this is a very large undertaking, and we'll be doing a pilot program, and so that will have my support, and I look forward to Wednesday to asking just further questions about what your plan is. So that was very exciting to see. I know that the 2% COLA, absolutely. Let me go ahead and say one thing right now. When you talked about, is there anybody willing to cut people or the COLA, this, I'm not. I would not be willing to do that, period. It has been hard for me to watch those years that the ones that are in the audience will remember, the ones watching at home. When I was first on the board, the first year was the year before the recession. And Mr. So, you'll remember that. It was back when things weren't so bad, and then it hit hard. And I always feel bad that we'll never be able to catch up where we were. And so I love the part of your presentation where you talked about we all kind of want to make things what they used to be, and we have to come to terms with we're not going to be there. I am one of those people that had to come to terms a couple of years ago that we're never going to be right back. I remember just thinking, well, we've got to go back and make people whole. And unfortunately, I feel like as a country, all private sectors, public entities like us, really suffered during that recession. And we do have a new normal to look at. But now that we are able to do something, even at 2%, not anything near what our staff deserves, but to know that we're able to start in that path and stay in that path of giving COLAs and we're not going backwards felt good to see that in the budget. And I agree that it should be there. I remember a year or two ago being asked why we put it in the budget to start with if we needed more money. Well, I can tell you we're going to continue to put that in the budget to start with, and we're going to look other places. We have got to pay our staff what they're worth and continue to show them Spotsylvania County is where we want them to be and where they belong, and we're very proud of what they're doing. I love what Ms. Shelley said about the ESOL and the other languages. I met with a couple of Chancellor High School, just amazing children, about a year ago, who brought your exact concerns to us, that they were going to school with children who were coming in from all over the country and in the world with a different language, and then they were asked to take SOLs, but they're not allowed to use anything but an English language book. They can't even use one, and they can't use interpreters. They have no help, but they're held to the same standard as all the other children. So that was a great point to make. It's just these are just little things we're talking about. It's just a touch on this huge umbrella of what I call, you know, our little city, you know, of people. Almost 24,000 little people that we're trying to get ready for the world, and I'm just so impressed. I'm so impressed. I would never live up to the standards that you all do as our teachers, principals, staffs, administrators. You're amazing. We're going to really roll up our sleeves. I think I say that every year, Wednesday night, and then that's where you'll see us start asking them more specific questions. But for right now, what a great presentation. We never, ever could pay you what you're worth, but I was glad to see that you put the 2% COLA in, and we're looking at other ways to make fill that gap. And I know as a board and with your leadership in the division, we're going to find the right ways to do it to where the instruction in the classroom are priority one, and that'll be my priority.
Mr. Braswell.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, I want to thank Dr. Baker and your staff for the hard work that was obviously put into this presentation, this budget presentation. I really appreciated the way you started your presentation and that you said you're going to talk to us. And I think as a community as a whole, we need to change the way we speak to one another. That includes all of the stakeholders that are involved in the presentation of the budget, our presentation to the Board of Supervisors, and everyone involved. We need to have an essence that we're all speaking to Spotsylvanians and that our children's best interests are at heart in this budget. After all, and I've always said this, a budget is nothing more than a financial representation of what you value. And so this budget, in its initial presentation, lines up with our strategic plan. And that's first and foremost. And it's getting our children college and career ready. And so I appreciate the effort of putting the bottom line up front in this budget. Now, there's some things in the budget, as Ms. Blaylock mentioned, that we're going to have to roll up our sleeves and negotiate and work with one another. There's some things in there that I like, and there's some things in there some other folks like. And I'll just go ahead and say there's some things in there that I like because I've been saying them for years, and it's activity fees. And I see that there's a reduction, and I want to roll up our sleeves on that because maybe we can go a little bit further. We've talked about this for several years, and I think it's a very recessive fee that we have our county citizens pay for their children participate in athletics. And so I'm looking to explore options to make a substantial decrease so that we can sunset this activity fee sooner than later. I am really thrilled about the issue of activity buses. When I first ran, it was an issue that I was very concerned with, and I agree in principle that we can't do things the way we used to do them, and I'm really supportive of the idea of looking at other innovative ways to help those students that live in the Berkeley and Livingston district have activity buses available. I remember sometimes riding to appointments in Orange and Louisa County, and as I ride through Spotsylvania to get there, I am impressed at the amount of land space that we have to travel in our county. Our buses travel each day to transport our students around, and those students don't need to just use the bus to get to athletic events. They need those buses to get to academic events. They need those buses to spend a little quality time with their teachers so that they can get some remediation and do other things besides the athletics. Sometimes, I kind of wish we would stop calling them athletic buses and just call them activity buses, because our students use them for a variety of different reasons, and it's not just athletics. And finally, I think we do have to be courageous in the way we explore courses of action to reduce the budget. You know, there are fiscal realities that we have to deal with, and I think one of them, those realities are the way we handle health insurance. And health insurance, the way we used to do it, may not be the answer. I don't know what the answer is. We have to look at the numbers, and we're going to have to, massage that some. But we have to be really creative now in developing courses of action that help us close the gap so that we can meet all of our budget priorities, so that we put children first. So with all that being said, and I do agree with Ms. Blaylock, I shouldn't have probably said that much, but I wanted to share on my heart how I feel as I approach the budget process and the things that I'll be looking for. But I do agree with Dr. Baker, first and foremost, that we need to talk to one another and do that with great respect and dignity, because no matter which side of the fence you're on, the children of Spotsylvania belong to us. Thank you.
Well, my colleagues have kind of inspired a different outlook with their comments than I was going to make, so I'm going to take a second just to say that I started Robert E. Lee Elementary School in 1985. And so I've been in this county, graduated high school from Cortland in 1998, and then started on the school board in 2014. And in those years, the changes that this county and these schools have embraced have been astronomical. So talking about us having to embrace a new norm, that's something that Spotsylvania County does and has done well since 1985. And our school system has always survived, and the kids have never lacked for a good education. But I can say that we're definitely making huge strides at a much higher rate as of the last 4 or 5 years, then I was jealous that I'm not a kid now. I really wish that I had the opportunities that our children do now. And I think that, I mean, if you look at our new norm, just since I've been here, the changes, our increase in disability services, our increase in English language learners, our increase in our gifted program, our increase in our investment in CTE, our increase in the STEM programs that we're trying to develop, our agriculture development. I mean, what we're trying to invest in is really valuable assets for careers. And I really wish that I had that then. And I really hope that we can continue to give children these choices to really make the most out of their high school and grammar school careers. looking at that, we have to figure out how ways to pay for it. And I, as well as everybody else, is really happy. Everything that we bring up since I've been on the board, all of our priorities have been addressed slowly but surely, and we're all getting everything that we've been asking for. Even if it's incremental, it's definitely getting addressed. It's some way or another, and we just have to figure out that we can't all reach the finish line at the same time. We just have to take little steps as we can to get there. One of my biggest things is just subpay. I mean, we have to be able to have substitutes in the classrooms when teachers aren't there. So, and that is a small budget, but we have to be able to pay for it. So one of my biggest jobs since General Assembly went in session this year has been contacting my legislators on a daily basis, supporting the slowdown of the VRS contribution for this year, because that would really help us budget-wise. So, and continuing to contact them about not approving any more unfunded mandates or underfunded mandates, because we just can't absorb them. So we can't do fix everything at the local level, but we're definitely gonna try as much as we can to shoot for it. But we really need our state legislators to help us and pass conservative legislation that's not going to be a burden on the localities. So we will keep pushing for that, and we will definitely research as much as we can and not give lip service to theoretical ways to save money. Make sure that it actually makes sense, and that it's going to actually, if it's been tried other places and failed, there's no point in us trying it, because if we know it's going to fail, we need to try new ways to increase budget capacity, and we will definitely be talking about that in our work sessions. If there isn't anything else this evening, I can take a motion for adjournment.
I move that we adjourn, Madam Chair.
Motion by Mr. Braswell. Second by Ms. Shelley. And we are now adjourned.